Welcome on into Massive Upset. Today is a big day because we're going over our Eastern Conference predictions for the regular season standings. I'll go 1 through 15. We'll talk more about the upper teams. Regular season standings predictions here. Big time sports content, pretty frequent for right now through the rest of Christmas break. It's going to be a lot of content. And then after that, it'll still be content. So guys, make sure you subscribe if you love basketball, if you love football, if you love baseball, you get it all here. And follow the Instagram account that'll not only give updates to this channel, but more sports content at Massive Upset. And as you could expect, the West version will be coming very shortly. Season did tip off last night, but only one East team played so far. So yeah, I'm sorry I'm slightly late, but I was just still figuring out what I wanted to do with my channel. But now we're rolling, and yeah, I did not change anything just based on how the Nets played last night. Still the same order. So do we want to go bottom to top? No, because this is one of those cases where I think it's more intriguing to go from the top to the bottom. And when I say the team, you'll be like, whoa, or like, yo, where is this team? Or you could perfectly agree with me. So number one seed in the East this year, I have it being the Milwaukee Bucks for a third straight season. Bucks were the literally best record in the NBA two straight seasons. They struggled in the bubble, but were so dominant before the pandemic last season. Their bubble play was a little concerning, but it's probably mostly a fluke, and they matched up with the Heat bad all season, not just in the bubble, but even in the regular season. The Heat owned the Bucks. This Bucks team was about 50-9 or something. They had 50 wins before they hit 10 losses last year. They were that dominant, and they upgraded their roster. This team got Jrue Holiday from the Pelicans. I think, in my opinion, the Bucks won the trade. They got Jrue Holiday, a quality player, over two kind of not very productive veterans in Eric Bledsoe and George Hill. So now the Bucks have a very strong top four. They have Jrue Holiday, Giannis, they have Middleton, and Brook Lopez. So to have Brook Lopez as your fourth player, That's good. The days of like Hill, Bledsoe, Ilyasova, Brogdon, Matthew, those are over, but this Bucks team still has some quality depth with DiVincenzo, Pat Connaughton. They brought in Torrey Craig. They brought in DJ Augustine. And Giannis is the best player in the NBA. He keeps getting better, so he has high standards, but he's going to be, I think, at least as good as last season. He's 26. He just turned 26. He was in the league for a lot of years, yet he's still like very young. So despite losing the second round in five games last year, I have the Milwaukee Bucks being the one seed for a third straight year. In my opinion, the two seed in the East this season is my favorite team, the Brooklyn Nets. We all know KD and Kyrie. Now, it's somewhat unclear exactly how KD is going to be like, if he's going to be like an eighth best player, or if he's going to be like back to that like top three form. Like when he went down, him and actually Kawhi in the 18-19 season were like the kings of that season. But it looks like Kevin Durant's going to be in the top five players again. He's been that good preseason and, of course, last night as he went off. But again, I had the Nets going as the two seed before I saw their impressive win in opening night. Kyrie Irving may be sleeping on him a bit, man, because he went off last night. And it was like a pleasure to watch last season, even though the Nets were below average, even with him on the court last year. Watching Kyrie last year, man, and last night, he went off. Kyrie Irving in a number two role is going to be so good. So we know about their deadly duo, but the Brooklyn Nets had underrated depth, killer underrated depth. Like, these aren't just blah players that are playing alongside KD and Kyrie. This team without KD and without Kyrie, this basically same squad last year made the playoffs. Kyrie, they had a better record without Kyrie than they had with Kyrie last year. Again, why I say Kyrie is more good in number two role than a number one role. But this Nets team went two games below 500, made the seventh seed in the playoffs last year. The fact that you're adding basically Kyrie Irving and you're adding Kevin Durant to that, people think that they might only move up to like a fourth seed. Only three seeds up, man. No, the Nets are going to be very... The Nets are so good. I love to say it, man. I really hope it doesn't disappoint, but the Nets, so fun. Because you have Dinwiddie, you have LeVert, you have the two reliable centers in Allen and Jordan. You have the shooting of Joe Harris, which I've even slept on a little. You've got Landry Shamet, who casually started for the Clippers a bit last year. You got the veteran Jeff Green. So yeah, I'm excited to be saying this. I would be surprised if the Nets are not top two in the East. All right, third seed, the Celtics. The Celtics are such a three seed, man. They landed there last year. They just barely squeaked into the conference finals. Didn't get killed in the conference finals either, but the Celtics team is going to win a playoff series, and then after that, they're going to be in a lot of close battles. Now, Kemba Walker is not healthy, so the Celtics, I feel like there's Bucks and Nets, I feel like are a pretty clear top two, just in my eyes, in this season. The Celtics, though, I have them at three. Kemba's supposed to come back, not missing much time, so hopefully that's not a big concern for them in their replacement this season. No more Gordon Hayward, but this Celtics team, Jason Tatum is so young, he's gonna get better. Jaylen Brown is so young, he's still getting better. These guys are so young, but they were already so good last year. Celtics were a three seed last year, but they beat the two seed in the playoffs. Number fourth seed, I'm going Philadelphia. Now, hear me out. I fully understand the Sixers were not very good last year. They were the sixth seed in the East. They were horrific on the road. But this year, the Sixers got better. The Sixers have a much better roster. A much better constructed roster, at least. Yes, they lost Al Horford, Josh Richardson, a couple of solid players for sure, but they did not fit in Philly. That was not a good fit, neither of those two. Three-point shooting is what they lacked, and what did they do? They brought in Seth Curry, they brought in Danny Green, and they got Dwight Howard to kind of make up for the height loss with Horford. And Dwight Howard, unlike Horford, instead of just being like a four guy, now Dwight Howard's going to be a reliable backup behind Joel Embiid. At least that's what I assume. The Sixers have a strong starting lineup now. Ben Simmons, Danny Green, Tobias Harris, Joel Embiid, that's four, and then you got Seth Curry, you got Thybulle, you got Korkmaz, you got Shake Milton. After not winning a playoff game last year, remember Ben Simmons was not in the bubble. I think Philadelphia will bounce back and win a playoff series, at least one playoff series. Number five seed, you guys were like, yo, where are they? Yeah, it's the Miami Heat. Now, again, three through five, very close. Boston, Philly, and Miami, I think it's gonna be very close to watch this year. Those three to five seed. So the Heat could finish three, but listen, the Heat made it to the finals last year, but this is exactly where they were. They were the fifth seed. Indiana finished above Miami last year, and Miami was healthy last year. They broke through in the bubble. They got so much, and remember, okay, short off season for the Heat, which hurts, but so much chemistry developed down in the bubble. But this team was together all of last year, and they finished fifth. It's a fun core for the Heat. They got Butler, they got Bam, they got Hero, they got Robinson, Andre Iguodala, Kendrick Nunn, Goran Dragic. This team, like, this is a team that if they stay together, they're gonna do big things. So if it goes how I said, which is very unlikely, then it would set up a very fascinating first round matchup of 5 seed defending Eastern Conference champion Miami against 4th seed Philly, which would be amazing. All right, so 6th seed, another good team. I guess you could say maybe three through six is kind of the tier, but I think the Raptors are a little bit behind. I'm putting them at 6. Now, the Raptors were a 2 seed last year, lost in the second round. They were a clear 2 to 3 seed type of team last year, but they lost Serge Ibaka and they lost Marc Gasol, two guys that were very key in their championship run, so they're gonna miss them. Lowry is getting older, Van Vliet still young, he's getting a little better. Pascal Siakam was very bad in the playoffs, so yeah, he'll improve on that, but it seems like best case is that he plays like he did in a terrific regular season last year. To make up for the height loss of Ibaka and Gasol, the Raptors have Aron Baynes, which is definitely a downgrade. The Raptors got okay depth guys, OG Anunoby, Norman Powell, Terrence Davis, not guys that are gonna impress you that much. Like, the Nets have just so much better depth guys. 7, Indiana. I feel like everyone who makes predictions is gonna have Indiana 7th this year in the East. Like, I feel like that's a clear top 6 in the East. And then you look, and the Pacers are still that's the only other team that you can look at and say, okay, you're actually a pretty good team. Pacers finished with a better record than Miami last year, but their best player last season, Domantas Sabonis, did not play in the series, and the Pacers got swept out of the playoffs for a second straight year. That's 2 straight years that the Pacers were in the 5 versus 4 matchup and got swept. And they lost to the Cavs in the 5 versus 4 matchup the year before that, and I believe they lost to the Cavs the year before that. So the Pacers are always kind of finishing at higher seeds than people are projecting them to every year, and they're going into this year very healthy with a lot of hope, but like, the East is actually better than it has been. Like, I'm for real this time. I know that's kind of something people say, oh, the East is a little better. This East, Kevin Durant is there. The Nets, an added team. The Heat have become a very good team. The Pacers still good. Celtics, Sixers, Bucks still there. The Raptors still good. Like, this East is very, they have the bad teams at the bottom, I'll tell you that. But the East and the West are comparable in their top six. The Pacers have a low-key, dangerous starting lineup. You got Brogdon, Oladipo, TJ Warren. You got Domantas Sabonis, who was their best player and an all-star last year. And then Miles Turner at the center position. And you got a guy like Jeremy Lamb also on that team. So this Pacers team, I would not be too surprised if they just casually played better than one of these teams in the top six. But it seems like another year that they're primed for a first round exit. Now the East eighth seed is very, very interesting. Where am I going? I'm going with Atlanta. This team had an amazing offseason and they're deep. They were bad. They were worse than people thought last year, but just the additions alone and the improvement of Trae Young. So who did they add? They added Rajon Rondo. They added Bogdan Bogdanovic. They added Clint Capella, Danilo Gallinari, and they got their young guys who they're hopeful for in John Collins and Cam Reddish. So now the 9 through 15, the non-playoff teams. I'll talk about the 9 and 10 because those are the guys who it would not take a shock to make the playoffs, and I got to kind of explain. So 9 seed is Washington. It's like a toss-up between Washington and Atlanta, I feel like, for the 8th and 9th. Two different teams. The Hawks have a star, but they have just a lot of depth on that team. And Washington is just a star-loaded team at the top with Beal and Westbrook, which is a very good duo. I don't know exactly how it's going to work, but I think it'll work pretty well. This team was only 25 and 47 last year. Now, I could kind of give them 24 and 40 because they went to the bubble where they had to play much superior teams, and they went 1-7 in the bubble. With the Wizards, though, it's just like you really gotta rely on the health of Westbrook and Beal, and if they're not like fully healthy full season, it's kind of hopeless. The depth just really does lack on this team. You got an okay center in Thomas Bryant. You got the three-point shooting of Davis Bertans, which a 9 seed, remember, gets you in the play-in. Same does the 10 seed. So I guess that's why I'm still talking about these guys. So if it happened like this, then Washington would go up at Atlanta having to win two straight. And I have the Magic at the 10 seed. So if they landed there, then they would have to travel to Indiana to win two straight if they wanted to get in the playoffs. But the Magic probably wouldn't do that. Why? Because they're not a very good team. That's why. They were not good last year. They were an 8 seed in the East, but they were definitely worse than they were the year before. No more veteran presence of DJ Augustine. And this team is not much different at all from the team that got the 8 seed last year, but two teams that I just mentioned, the Washington and Atlanta, they definitely improved. The Magic did not improve. And it should be the same top seven as last year, just Brooklyn rising from a mediocre 7 seed to a lethal, superior, great team. The duo of Gordon and Vucevic remains, and you got the young presence of rookie Cole Anthony, and you got Markel Fultz, but I don't see them playing very big roles. The Magic, 10 seed. So now I'm just going to go through my order for 11 through 15. I have Charlotte at 11, Detroit Pistons at 12 after a miserable season last year. I think they'll bounce back slightly. I have the Bulls at 13. They're such a 13 seed. Knicks at 14, and the Cavaliers at 15. There's not a ton to say about that bottom teams. The Hornets could be pretty exciting to watch this year with Gordon Hayward and a core that they kind of were building up last year. And I feel like the Pistons have a chance to not necessarily be terrible. So it's really the Bulls, the Knicks, and the Cavs. This should be a third straight year where none of them are knocking on the playoff door. Thanks so much for watching, guys. Leave a thumbs up if you want more content and support the work that goes into the vid. It'll mean so much to me, guys. I really be stumbling over my words a lot today, boys. Be sure to subscribe, guys, because we're on a lot of upload grind here on Christmas break.